nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You may be seated. Good afternoon. We gather today to honor and celebrate the life of Tara Blanche Gish, beloved child of God, wife, sister, aunt, and friend. With thanksgiving, we remember how her life touched ours and the lives of all those she knew. We gather to say farewell and to mourn our loss, but we celebrate the rich life that she lived. We come together to worship our triune God. I'm Arlene Champion, the deacon here at St. Aidan Anglican Church. On behalf of the family, I thank you for coming today, either in person or virtually through the live stream, and for offering your love and support to them at this difficult time. Following the service, you are invited to a reception to take place at Russell and Tara's home for a time of fellowship and an opportunity to share some of your memories of Tara. Immediately following the service, though, Russell and the family will be in the parish hall through those doors that we just came in for a short time to greet those of you who are unable to attend the reception. Interment of Tara's ashes will take place at a later date in the family plot in Yellowgrass. I came to know Tara when she and Russell began attending St. Aidan about 14 years ago. That was just soon after you moved to Moose Jaw, wasn't it, Russell? They arrived here quietly, and in true Tara fashion, it wasn't long before she became very quietly but involved in several ministries in our parish. I say quietly because just all of a sudden you saw Tara was part of a ministry. And later you heard that it was a special interest she had or an experience or education that she had, and she offered her skills. Her wisdom, her ability to see what needed to be done, her vision for how it should be done, and her willingness to do it. But at the same time, her ability to bring others on board with her have been an incredible gift, both to our parish and for the community of Moose Jaw. When I think back, I think the very first ministry that she became involved in was that of running the sound system for Sunday worship services. And she was often available to do so for weddings and funerals as they came up. In time, we began looking at a capital campaign to renovate our parish hall. Tara offered her assistance, having worked as a not-for-profit gift planner for many years and in several organizations. And she was invaluable in this position, which she held for several years in our parish. She could also be seen helping out in the kitchen with our outreach lunches, on occasion singing in some of our choirs. She served on vestry until her cancer diagnosis. Her background and experience were so much appreciated at that table, and we greatly missed her when she had to step back from that position. In serving with Tara, we became friends. She invited my husband and I to some of the plays she was involved in with the Moose Jaw Community Players, allowing us to see yet another side of Tara, one she loved and again one she excelled at. And for any of you who ever got to see her in action on the stage, you know she was not quiet there. Tara was an extraordinary woman, and I will greatly miss her warmth, friendship, wisdom, love, and her gentle, friendly smile. I now invite Lena Rutherford, a longtime friend with whom Tara shared a lot of life with, and Russell described as Tara's spiritual sister, to offer a tribute in memory of Tara.
It works. That's so great. It is said that it takes a long time to make an old friend. And in this case, it took 43 years, 43 great years of friendship with Tara. Another one of Tara's old friends, Ray, and I were reminiscing last week and realizing that apart from family, there's not a lot of people present who would date that far back. And we wondered, you know, most people don't know that much history about Tara, and so does that make us prehistoric friends? Possibly, and my back is feeling that way today. Mind you, even that history that we share is still post-history of some very interesting tidbits that family would know, like my introduction to Tara was still post her figure skating career days. Also, her insight to collect Barbies and their accessories and keep them in Tara fashion, which is pristine, something that's now considered vintage and probably might supplement you in your retirement, Russell. I count it such an honor and a great blessing to have shared these years of friendship with Tara. When asked to share this tribute, it seemed fitting but also odd to me that a song came to my mind as I was on the phone with you, Shannon. It seems a bit of an odd song, I know. When I looked it up, I thought it even stranger that this song would be nudging at me until I did some probing with it, pondering about it. It's the song Maria from The Sound of Music. And the chorus goes, "How do you solve a problem like Maria?" And I thought, that's not a good thing to say at a tribute. But it goes on to say, "How do you catch a cloud and pin it down? And how do you hold a moonbeam in your hand?" I'm not alluding at all to Tara as a problem. However, she was very Maria-like in many ways, and not just in the fact that they both had lovely voices. Maria was a woman who, being very gifted and compassionate and delightful, finds that she's just not created to live in the box of some of the traditional expectations that are part of her culture and society there. She's restless to go beyond the expected, and places or opportunities for her, and she does that with gusto, and that makes me think of Tara. When I first met Tara, she was paying her bills by honing her drafting skills at SaskTel. Engaging predominantly with pencil and paper, however, was not the fulfillment she had been looking for, although I do suspect that the skills she developed there really helped her in her amazing Lego creations that she's been famous for lately. She yearned to understand the complexities of people, and therefore she exchanged her little Pacer car. She always had the most interesting vehicles. Her little Pacer car for a vehicle that allowed her to move out to BC to start a degree in psychology at Trinity Western University. Now, as she pressed on through that degree, it became apparent to her that maybe God was calling her to a different way of serving people. And I think, as a social worker, imagine that. There's another way to serve people besides psychology? Obviously, there is. So she set her head and her heart and diligent being to pursuing a law degree at UBC. She worked hard to set up her law practice there in Vancouver and enjoyed various aspects of that field, however, also feeling boxed in and frustrated by the constraints and focus of making law a business. So in true Tara form, and in pursuit of a fulfilling career in helping people, she closed up shop and decided to use her law experience and understanding to work in the field of fundraising. This is something I have so appreciated about Tara. She wasn't too afraid to step out of the comfortable or the familiar to do something new or different. She was extremely brave. If she felt it was something that fit her passion for creativity or to help people or for an adventure or new opportunity to learn and stretch her brain, then she was willing to risk. And I really admire her for that. I admire Tara for her integrity, her pursuit of honesty and personal ethics and compassion towards others. Even when frustrated by people or situations, it was important for her to try and understand what this experience was like for the other person. She was diligent and she was determined and undaunted by challenge. Something seen in how she tackled a difficult cancer diagnosis and was able to search out and investigate some helpful, non-traditional interventions. She wasn't just going to take anybody's answer at face value. Tara knew how to set her sights on a goal and pursue it, or in one case, pursue him. I remember one of her trips home in the summer, and she started talking about this handsome, interesting artist she had met at church in Vancouver and how she was on an agenda to get his attention. So I don't remember if I was with her when she bought this postcard or if she told me about this, but she picked a very specific Saskatchewan postcard so he would get something in the mail. She also arranged to be very helpful to him in setting up for one of his art shows. She wanted to find ways to show Russell, to help him realize just how valuable it would be for her to be a part of his life. And it seems that after 29 years of marriage, together we can appreciate another one of Tara's successful and delightful adventures. Tara loved a problem or a challenge, even if it meant putting together an IKEA kitchen. And she was pretty skilled because, you know, I don't even know if she needed the diagrams. She might not have needed the pictures that came along. But together they have created various renovation projects, and she is definitely a competent foreman. She loved a challenge because it gave her an opportunity to brainstorm a solution, and she loved to use her brain and had a deep appreciation for this gift and provision that God had given her. She was also someone you could describe as definitely an independent thinker, and she spent significant time sorting through issues and perspectives and values. We didn't always come to the same conclusion in our pondering together, but her thoughts were always needful of worthy consideration, and she certainly challenged you to think intelligently and present your case well. I found that despite how strongly she felt about her convictions or conclusions, she would try hard to intertwine them with consideration of others. And she was mostly successful at that. These various qualities, although admirable and praiseworthy in so many ways, also could sometimes be described as potentially stubborn. And I think that sometimes she would like to have realized more how her strong focus and direction impacted others. That sometimes while you're blazing your trail, you can be a little oblivious to the experiences of others around you. While many prairie folks move increasingly westward through their years, Tara and Russell pursued an easterly wind that blew them Saskatchewan ways, and they landed in Moose Jaw in hopes of being closer and more connected with the family that meant so much to them. This move was one of flourishing for Tara as she started to understand the need to balance her life more between work, which had been so consuming, and play. It seems that she was really able to discover and pour herself into a passion for building and supporting community. And Arlene has mentioned a lot of that has happened right here at St. Aidan's, and some of the other things. As we are probably all aware, Tara was a real character, and she loved to live that out in the various roles that community theater allowed her. She was involved in both acting and writing and directing. She knew how to handle a mean power tool, which came in especially handy for creating various sets, a challenge she thoroughly enjoyed and spoke to me about often with a glint in her eye and the excitement rising in her voice. Perhaps she loved that so much because it combined two of her favorite things, problem solving and power tools. Tara had a great love of music that grew through the years, and these past few years were very rewarding for her as she found a music family here in Moose Jaw. The opportunity to combine her love of music and care for people inspired the formation of the local Comfort Choir, a rich experience that yielded not just musical opportunity, but for Tara, the formation of a sense of family and her involvement in her choirs and community in various forms here gifted her with something that was very meaningful to her, which were the gift of soul friends. She was busy working at community problem solving and supporting in many ways, both pre-diagnosis, post-diagnosis, through chemo and beyond, which I am so admiring of. At a time when most of us would hunker in and become very self-focused, she still found a way to continue to look out and see beyond herself and to find fulfillment in living that way. She spent some time running for city council. I spent some time folding and stuffing envelopes in that endeavor. And I was actually relieved when she wasn't called to that task. I thought, oh, Tara, I cannot imagine how you would have time for that and everything else. She was busy with the Moose Jaw Businesswomen and their PRISM Awards, which excited her to do something that really supported and encouraged women, because she so desired to live her life outside of the constraints that she felt sometimes were imposed on her as a woman. I shall always be grateful for Tara's care and encouragement in my life as a young Christian. Her very kind and gentle spirit to both human and beast. I suspect that Tara never met a dog whose ears she did not yearn to reach out and scratch. I'm grateful for the inspiration of her integrity and determination, her loving and loyal friendship. Tara was a moonbeam that you couldn't contain and a cloud that you couldn't pin down. She blazed her own trail. She was a woman to be reckoned with. She was brave enough to listen for a new drumbeat and dance for a non-traditional dance, and I love her for this. I know that my reflection is only a part of your greater Tara experience. And so it is my hope that sometime you will take some moments to reflect on your own specific experiences with Tara and stop and give thanks to God for the gift of Tara, because it says in his word that every good gift comes from him, and she certainly was that to us, a good, good gift. We are hurting today with her physical absence. This is a pain for us because it's not the way that we were originally designed. This does not fit us very well, because God in his original design did not create us to be separated from him or from those that are dear to us. And so this causes us pain. It doesn't fit very well. God understands this, thankfully. In one of our last few visits together, Tara and I had the opportunity to share a quiet and wonderful time of reflection on Scripture and sharing communion together. We spoke of the wonderful provision of Jesus Christ, who has made a way for us to be restored to that original design again, which is the opportunity to live forever without the painful separation from God or from those who are dear to us. I'm so grateful for this work of Christ out of the great love of God. This restoration is now Tara's experience, and that we can rejoice in. Because in Christ, death is not the end of living. It is only the end of dying.
Thank you, Lena. As we continue in worship today, you will need the green prayer book, the Book of Alternative Services, at times. You won't need that until later on in the service, but we will be using it later on. But the blue hymn book, Common Praise, trust me, we are going to be using it a lot. Would we expect anything but lots of music from Tara? I'm sure that as we go through the remainder of this service, that you're going to see Tara's fingerprints in much of it, especially in the readings that you'll be hearing and in the music. She chose them all. Today, we remember Tara in life with us, and we celebrate her new life in our heavenly home, where she has joined all those who have gone before her. Let us join with praise and thanksgiving in the communion with all those saints in heaven, and give glory to our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Oh, come, let us worship. Lena told us about the Comfort Choir. You don't get to just hear them today, you get to, or you don't get to hear about them today, but you get to hear them, and we invite you to join in singing with them. We're very grateful for them to be with us today. So I invite you now to take the blue hymn book and turn to hymn number 384, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. And we will be singing together verses 1, 2, and 6. May be seated. I now invite Ray Hendrickson, another longtime faithful friend of Tara's, who also shared a lot of life with her. And Russell described their relationship as them being soul sisters. So Ray, I invite you now to come and read Psalm 139, verses 1 to 17.
I'm honored today to offer you this psalm, Psalm 139, verses 1 to 17. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. You press upon me behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. Where then can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I climb up to heaven, you are there. If I make the grave my bed, you are there also. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost part of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will cover me, and the light around me turned to night. Darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light to you are both alike. For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well. My body was not hidden from you while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. They were fashioned day by day, when as yet there was none of them. How deep I find your thoughts, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of all consolation, in your unending love and mercy, you turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life. Show compassion to your people in their sorrow. Be our refuge and our strength to lift us from the darkness of grief to the peace and light of your presence. Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by dying for us, conquered death, and by rising again, restored life. May we then go forward eagerly to meet him, and after our life on earth, be reunited with our brothers and sisters, where every tear will be wiped away. We ask this through Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Cora Melanson, who with her husband Ross were one of the first couples that Tara and Russell came to know when they moved to Moose Jaw. They connected on many levels, becoming very near and dear friends over the years. I now invite Cora to read our first lesson.
A reading from Isaiah. A voice says, "Cry out." And I said, "What shall I cry?" All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, flowers fade, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite you now to turn in our hymn book to hymn 611, as we join 611. singing Our Father, We Have Wandered. We will sing the first two verses, but there is one more verse that the Comfort Choir will sing without us. I now invite Michelle Josephson, a fellow parishioner and friend of Tara's, who will read our second lesson.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord. Thanks be.
I invite you to again turn to our hymn book, to hymn number 505, Be Thou My Vision. And we will be singing verses 1, 2, and 3. Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. You may be seated. This passage of scripture that I just read from the Gospel of John was very meaningful and important to Tara. It was the last piece of scripture she wanted to hear and did hear as she asked me to read it to her minutes before she died. She also chose it for us to hear today. In it, Tara found not only the identity of her Lord and Savior, but her own identity. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. To all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or flesh or the will of man, but of God. Tara did not take that lightly or for granted. She knew and in no way doubted that she was a beloved child of God. In addition to identity, this passage informed and assured her of Christ's endless grace and mercy in her life. As I read, the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. From his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. Grace is something that Tara spoke deeply of in those last days' visits that we had. Shannon told me that she wasn't always so sure and aware of this grace, though. Daryl and Garth said that they were brought up to be independent, to be themselves. And that was Tara, wasn't it? However, she shared with Shannon that there was a time that she never felt she was good enough until she had her Missionary Alliance days, and the gift of those days was being introduced to grace. She was grateful for that teaching and experience that enabled to live her life in the acceptance of God's grace, giving her the confidence to be independent and herself a much-loved child of God. She told me that as she made decisions, even in how she chose to die, that she prayed and discerned. But she knew that if she had gotten it wrong, Jesus loves her and forgives her. By accepting God's grace, she lived her life in it and by it. From the time Tara was very young, as Lena told us, she was driven to find out how things worked. Garth and Daryl shared with me about a picture of Tara when she was very young, and she had every pot and pan hauled out of the cupboard, checking them all out. As a child, she liked to get into places she was told not to go. She told Russell last week about being curious about a construction site and wanting to see how the building was being built. She crawled into the basement to check it out, and then she couldn't get back out. Fortunately, she had taken someone with her who was just not quite as curious and had not followed her into that basement, and that child was able to go get help to get her out. Tara's dad was a farmer and a mechanical maintenance manager. Now, Lena told us that Tara sometimes was frustrated by some of the constraints put on females. Well, that was at home, too, because in those days, Daryl and Garth told me that girls didn't do farm work. And that frustrated Tara because she always wanted to learn the ins and the outs of the farming. But that was Garth and Daryl's territory. She did make up for it, though, always after her dad about how things were made or how they worked. One day, and I understand if I got this right, that it was well into adulthood, Tara was out fixing her car when her dad came out to watch and check what his little Bitsy, as he fondly called her, was doing. In short order, he said, "You should have been an engineer." Well, from what I gather, Tara's response was kind of that he should have recognized that long before then. Many of us know, and Lena told us about, too, the amazing carpentry skills that she had. And I have to say that I actually have very detailed instructions she sent me on how to caulk my baseboards. She offered to come and help me get started, and I put the job off a little bit too long. But fortunately, I do have her instructions whenever the Spirit moves me. That constant quest to know how things worked from a young age developed a mind that was not only technical and creative, but artistic. Her thinking ability allowed her to have a vision of something. And then through critical, analytical, artistic thinking, it allowed her to make it happen. Lena shared with us some of her various vocations over the years. I have to say again that it was Tara's desire to make life better for the world and for people. As she found helping people with their wills, a way to make wills and stewardship profitable in terms of what, where, and how you left your assets, leading her to estate planning, bequests, and eventually the professional not-for-profit fundraiser. Tara was a fine example of a Christian lawyer, and in her own way, she did make the world a better place for many, in ways that in many cases are still to come through some of those bequests that she helped develop. Tara admitted to always having an awareness of God's presence in her life. Her family was the first to tell me the other day that Tara wasn't a saint. She likely, and I'm sure has told some of you that herself. She had her faults, but she definitely lived in God's presence. She always knew what He was calling her to do. And as that calling kept changing and evolving, she met each new challenge with enthusiasm. Quoting her brothers, Tara's life was a string of good deeds. She told them, though, that it's not about the deeds we do, but about acceptance. Again, God's grace shining forth like a bright light through her. Her drive, forthrightness, loyalty, and honesty shone brightly. She was a community builder, doing things because they were important to her. But she built and fostered community by nature in what and how she did what she did. She discerned the need, had the vision, thought it out how best it would work, and then she shared that vision with those that she knew would catch it and run with it. Because of Tara's insights and her ability to develop and organize in that, we are a much, much richer community because of her. Whether it was the community choir, the Moose Jaw Business Women's Association, here at St. Aidan, she always was there helping and could see things that many of us couldn't. Tara was modest about what she did, though. Russell told me that he liked going to parties and receptions because that way he found out what she was really up to, what she was doing. She brought none of it home to him. Home was their sanctuary. She wanted separation between home and world. But when they were out, people would approach her about various things that she was involved in. And Russell got to find out what all she really was doing. He told me that when Tara was into a project, she was so focused that he could go up to her office and talk to her, but in her zone, she wouldn't even know he was there. Sometimes Shannon shared that they would talk professionally, and she would share some of her accomplishments with her that she might otherwise not have shared, but she was hesitant to tell people what she did. She felt that that was bragging, and Daryl pointed out that that was a sin in her eyes, saying that pride and prejudice had no place in Tara's life. They were two big no-nos. One day, Tara said to Shannon that she did not have a very good prayer life, that she didn't feel that she had good prayer habits. Well, when Shannon shared that with us the other day, we all laughed and said, she had the prayer life we all should have. She walked and talked with God in everything she did. She lived her life in Christ. As I sat with her family this week, we all agreed that the reading that Michelle read us from the book of Romans that Tara had chosen for us today was a checklist for life. And as we went through it, looking at Tara's life, we just kept checking off all the boxes. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Don't repay evil for evil. And take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. It carries on. It is so much of who Tara was. It also says, by the mercies of God, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed to the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Again, God's mercy and grace underlie all of this and fuel Tara in every facet of her life. She professed to be a bit of a control freak. However, everything she did was done with an eye to discerning the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Although she often was quiet, we all know she was not afraid to speak up if she did not agree or saw a better way for something. And often she had spent more time than us trying to figure out what was the best way to do it. She did not force her thoughts and ideas on you, but as Russell pointed out the other day, her training as a lawyer showed her how to bring you around to what needed to be done. She also was willing to listen to you, and her mind could be changed, which again was part of her never-ending discernment. And in the end, she was quick to say that if her discernment was wrong, and she did not act out the will of God, she knew he loved her, and through Jesus' promise of salvation and eternal life, through his death on the cross and resurrection, she knew she would be forgiven. Tara held tight to Jesus' promise of salvation and eternal life, and his mercy and grace throughout that battle that she fought with cancer. As we heard in the Gospel of John, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Tara approached her illness as she approached everything in life. She did not, as Lena said, just accept traditional medicine. She researched, she dug deep for alternate treatments, which may be more effective and allow her a better quality of life. She fought that battle with hope, continuing to make this world a better place, even in the face of death this past week, when she was told that she had but a few days left in her earthly journey. The darkness did not overcome her, and she continued to reflect the light of Christ shining in the darkness, especially with her smile that lit up the room. Tara in true Tara fashion, made up her mind, using the same approach she used for everything in life, to face death through the provision of MAID. She asked me to come and see her in the hospital. She asked my thoughts on MAID when I got there. I told her my thoughts did not matter. That was between her and God, and not for me to judge. She thanked me for the grace I offered her in that, and asked me to pray with and for her as she prepared, to offer my support to her family. And she gave me directions, very detailed, explicit directions for this service, but with the caveat that these were her suggestions. But it was important for me to let Russell know he had the final say in the worship that we have today. She reached out to her family and friends and let them know her decision. She invited them to spend time with her in the next few days. Last Thursday, surrounded by her closest family and friends, we all prayed together. She said her farewells to all of us, and she reached out her hand, asking Jesus to end her suffering and pain, and please take her hand and take her home. May she rest in peace and rise in glory. Tara will be missed by all of us, but none so much as by you, her family. Russell, when Tara and I were talking, she told me that you two married in your 30s. She said that unless the right guy came along, she was having no part of marriage. She was prepared to live a single life, not willing to sacrifice it for a bad marriage. But God brought you together, and Tara, as we heard earlier from Lena, knew that you were that right guy. The love you shared for 29 years was deep and a gift from God and to each other. Please know that each of us here upholds you in prayer as you mourn her passing, and we're here for you, especially in those times when you need some support. To all of us, hold tight to your memories. Don't forget the lessons she taught you. Hold her love in your hearts forever. Miss her, cry those tears, and remember, God assures us, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. These are not the words of a casual friend, but the words of the God who loves you deeply. Turn to him in prayer, and he will comfort and strengthen you. When Tara and I talked about her death, she said the hardest part was saying goodbye. We both agreed that this was not goodbye, but till we meet again. God bless, my friend. Amen. I invite you in the Green Prayer Book to turn to page 592, and if you are able, to stand with me as we affirm our faith, as Tara has done so many times in her life, with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I now invite Russell's sister Shannon, who describes herself as Tara's sister from another mother, to come and lead us in the prayers of the people. I invite you to take the position suitable for you for prayer, standing, sitting, or kneeling.
Tara's lack of a prayer life was just kind of goofy, because she did go on to say, you know, I don't really pray. I just talk to God all day. Oh, that I would remember to just talk to God all day. Friends, we are going to join our hearts together in whatever way you imagine God to be for you. Let's pray. God of grace, we thank you for Tara, who was so near and dear to us, and who has now been taken into your glory. We thank you for the friendship she gave and for the strength and peace she brought. We thank you for the love she offered and received while she was with us on earth. We pray that nothing good in this woman's life will be lost, but will be of benefit to the world, that all that was important to her will be respected by those who follow, and that everything in which she was great will continue to mean much to us now that she has left this earthly realm and abides in your divine heart. We ask you that she may go on living in her family and friends, in their hearts and minds, in their courage and their consciences. For a moment, let us in silent remember with thanksgiving all those things about Tara that we hold so dear in our heart. We ask you that we who were close to her may now be even closer to each other, and that we may in peace and friendship here on earth always be deeply conscious of your promise to be faithful to us in death, as faithful as you have been with Tara. We pray for ourselves. Let us not avoid the painful lessons of grief, but in the company of one another, lean into the grief and into your comforting presence. May God grant us courage and confidence in the new life of Christ. We ask this in the name of the risen Lord. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, You are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Terah. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. The eternal God is our dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Blessed is the Lord, our strength and our salvation. I invite you now to take the hymn book again and turn to page to hymn 403, and we sing Let All Things Now Living. May the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make us complete in everything good, so that we may do his will working among us, that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. This brings our service to a close today. Again, Russell invites you to their home for a reception. The address is on the back of the bookmark that you received when you arrived. And again, for those of you who may not be able to attend the reception, Russell and the family will be in the hall for a short time where you may go and greet them. The last time I was with Tara in the hospital, I asked her if she had any last message or theme that she wanted me to bring out in this service. She said she had to think about it, and I said to her that if she came up with something, that to either write it down or tell Russell or give it to him to give to me when we met. When I got the sheet of her instructions from them when we met the other day, there was one whole sheet, two columns of music. But there's one particular piece that's circled and labeled the last one. As I listened to it, I feel that this may be her last message to us that she left for us to hear. I told you earlier that she told me that saying goodbye was the hardest part of death. I think that this piece of music that we're going to listen to was Tara's final message of farewell to us. It is from the movie 1917 and sung by Joe Slovak. I invite you to listen to the words.
Traveling through this world of woe, yet there's no sickness, toil, nor danger in that bright land to which I go. I'm going. But golden fields lie just before me, where God's redeemed shall ever sleep. I'm going home to see my mother and all my on. I'm only gone. I'll soon be free from every trial. My body sleep in the churchyard. I'll drop the cross of self-denial and enter on my great reward. I'm going there to see my Savior, to sing his praise.